Nerds. Bem-vindos, nerds tetudos, fãs de jogos. Aqui quem fala é o Ogro, analista de eSports. Hoje eu chamei o Anthony do True Game Data para conversar com a gente. Nós já fizemos outras entrevistas com outros influenciadores, então a gente vai se esforçar agora para fazer com um falante da língua inglesa. Ele é responsável pelo site True Game Data que a gente usa para fazer todos aqueles gráficos, aqueles plots de TTK por distância. Ele atualiza aqueles dados com frequência, testando todas as armas do jogo e de acordo também com as atualizações. Muito obrigado pela presença aqui, Tony.
Oh yeah, it's awesome to be here.
Como começou essa ideia de você criar um website com todas as características de todas as armas do jogo?
So, I've always been a big first-person shooter player, and my background is, I have an engineering degree, mechanical engineering degree, and I've always been really interested in data and things like that, and I got really into Warzone right when it came out. I was playing Apex Legends beforehand. I was like the first BR I had played, so I played that for a couple months. And then when Warzone came out, I basically just dropped Apex completely and started playing Warzone exclusively. So that was in like March. I think I started playing right when it came out. And I was just really frustrated by the fact that nothing like True Game Data existed because I'm obsessed with data and min-maxing my builds and things. I just really wanted a source where I could build weapons and figure out what I thought was the best for each situation. And it was probably like 2 months in, a month and a half in, I was watching all of J-God's videos and Exclusive Aces videos and trying to, you know, figure out what was the best. But obviously their videos, so they were older, the data was from the past, and I couldn't tweak the stuff in their videos. I just had to use the numbers they had in their videos instead of being able to add attachments myself and see how that changed things. And because I came from engineering and data analytics and programming background, one day I just was like, I'm sure people would love this. I'm just gonna do it myself. So I just started programming, and I think we had like the initial version of the site up within like 3 or 4 days after we decided to do it. But now it feels like it takes a year to change anything. But at the beginning, it was pretty quick.
Você esperava o tamanho e o alcance que o seu site recebeu, que o seu site tomou?
I thought it was pretty unique that something else like the website didn't really exist yet, so I thought there was a chance it could be huge. That's part of the reason why we worked on it so hard for those first 3 days. I mean, we worked all day, first 3 days, because I was like, somebody else is going to do this, and it's going to just take my opportunity to do something cool away. So I just, we worked super, super hard to try to get it out there and done quickly, because we thought it could be huge. Me and Christina, she's the other person, she's the programmer that I've been working with since the start. But yeah, we thought it could be really big, but obviously didn't have any real idea of what it could be, so.
Você se tornou facilmente uma das personalidades mais importantes da comunidade de COD Warzone, mesmo não sendo um jogador ou um streamer profissional. Como você vê isso?
I think it's pretty cool and unique, just kind of like J-God, where we're kind of different content creators than, you know, what's traditionally been the main source of content for these games is just really good gameplay, professional gameplay, and just awesome games and high kill games and things like that. And, you know, we're just doing something differently, where we're just purely trying to inform people and you know, help them play the game better and get better at the game. So it's interesting to be in that situation, because really, there aren't too many people that do that. There are some, but I really enjoy it. Obviously, I enjoy streaming and, you know, making YouTube videos and stuff, so it's pretty cool. It's a very cool place to be.
Interacting with people, for you, is this a challenge or is it a pleasure?
So, I've always been someone who had like really bad stage fright and was really afraid of public speaking and things like that. For some reason, streaming, I had never had any problem with. Streaming was always totally fine. Interacting with people, like in a live sense, I had no problems with at all. But making YouTube videos was really hard for me to start with, because it was just like, it felt like public speaking. I had to talk to a camera, which is like not something I was ever used to doing. And I had to really learn how to do that and get comfortable with that. But at this point, it's not really an issue for me. I've done it enough. I made the YouTube like August of last year, so I'm pretty used to it at this point.
Essa facilidade no live streaming pode ser por conta de você estar conversando com uma audiência que é mais geek, mais gamer, né, que tem gostos parecidos com você?
I'd say that's definitely part of it. I think the main difference in being more comfortable for streaming for me is, I don't know why, but just like live interacting with people as compared to recording something for a camera is just feels totally different to me. I don't know why that is, because you'd think, you know, public speaking is something that, like I said, I've always just despised doing and just made me super, super uncomfortable. And that's live. So I don't know why it's different, but for some reason, maybe it's because there's no people directly in front of me or something. I don't know. Twitch streaming is just a lot. It's been a blast. Honestly, Twitch has been one of the best things I've ever done. Just, I've met so many amazing people and made awesome friends and stuff. So I love it.
That's so good to hear, man. Really. Como você vê o Warzone no futuro? Tem alguma ideia de como os modos competitivos profissionais serão?
So, competitive, like, tournaments and stuff right now in Warzone are a little bit messy for a lot of reasons. A big one is cheaters. Obviously, in tournaments, you have the best players usually that play the game. So, skill-based matchmaking, if that exists, is going to throw you in with the other best players, which are going to be cheaters a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. So, that becomes a real big mess for these huge $100,000 tournaments and things like that. They have to get that under control. I don't know if they can even do that from the technical side of things for this Warzone. Maybe in like a future iteration of Warzone when they update the engine and stuff, maybe they can implement a true anti-cheat. So that's one big thing they're gonna have to deal with. I think the best, it's also a problem that we don't have any like ranked systems. So with skill-based matchmaking, if you're playing in a tournament, depending on what time of day you're playing and where you're located and all kinds of stuff, you can get different difficulties of lobbies. That's why I really like, in competitive sense, the format for tournaments that I like is the 2v2 kill race, where you're in the same lobby as the person you're competing against. Therefore, skill-based matchmaking is going to be the same, and you're just competing mm-hmm. to, you know, see who gets the most kills. So I think more tournaments in that format would be the best. I think private matches could be great too, but right now private matches just have so many issues with getting started and people getting kicked, and just they're kind of a mess too. But I think down the line, private matches and like 2v2 kill races will probably be the best.
O que você mudaria no jogo hoje em dia?
What would I change in the game right now? This is I just recorded a video on this like 2 days ago that I have not posted yet, but I will use those reasons, so give me a second.
Spoiler alert
is right. They changed some of it in this season 4 patch. They did a good job with like the barrel changes and things, but I can talk about that some too. One of the things that's been bothering me since the Cold War integration was just how the Cold War weapons are balanced differently than the Modern Warfare weapons, because the attachments all work differently. Mm-hmm. Like they had a different methodology for balancing in Cold War, Black Ops Cold War. And when they tried to pull those guns into Warzone and you have both Modern Warfare weapons and Cold War weapons, it's just weird that they don't have the same attachments. They're not really balanced the same ways, but they're working. That's one of the things they just changed, is they gave us these new barrel changes for the season 4 update, where Cold War guns now have essentially the long barrels of the Modern Warfare weapons. So that's a really good change. That's one thing I was really wanting them to change. But the problem with that is they had been tweaking all the Cold War guns the whole time to try to make them balance with the Modern Warfare guns. And now they give us these really, really good Modern Warfare attachments, essentially, for the Cold War guns. So now all the Cold War guns are like ridiculously good. So it's like just making all the Modern Warfare guns obsolete. Let's see, skill-based matchmaking. My opinion on that is it's a business decision for them, obviously. They want to make the most money they can, that makes sense. I hate skill-based matchmaking, obviously, because it makes my games harder, but it's never gonna go away. But what I'd like to see changed with that would be maybe give us a ranked mode, so we have, if we're gonna have strict skill-based matchmaking, at least give us a ranked mode so we can see ourselves progressing, rather than right now we're just only playing in public matches and there's really no way. You can look at your stats, but you never know if your stats are increasing because you got easier mm-hmm. lobbies, or if they're increasing because you actually got better, and that's a really frustrating thing to me. So I think a ranked mode with strict skill-based matchmaking, and then public matches with just, you know, still skill-based matchmaking but just not as strict, maybe would be one thing they could do for that. And there's other games that have that, like Apex Legends has ranked modes and stuff like that, and I think that could be really good for Warzone. Something else that I've thought about a lot, I think Warzone time to kills are just a little bit too low overall. Mm-hmm. So I would like to see maybe like an increase to your base health or something. I haven't put tons of thought into like actual numbers behind this, but just overall an increase to base health, and maybe decrease how much plates give you a little bit in terms of health, because right now with 100 base health, if you have no plates and the other person has plates, you're pretty much going to lose that fight every single time. There's just almost no chance. So I'd like to see like 150 base health or something, and then plates do like 30. So mm-hmm. that's just totally random numbers, but I'd like to see plates reduced in terms of how good they are, but overall maybe a little bit more health, just because I want the TTKs to go up a little bit, just because it's very frustrating when you just die before you can even react. And I just, that doesn't seem like a very, I don't know, a very good way to design a game to me. Those are a couple nice things.
O que você fazia antes de desenvolver o site e se hoje você se dedica somente a ele.
So I, like I said earlier, have a mechanical engineering degree. So I worked, while I was still in school for the last like year, year and a half, I worked full-time over the summer and part-time during the school year, doing data analytics and telematics and programming for Caterpillar, like the company that makes heavy machinery.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so I worked there for like a year and a half, 2 years while I was still in school. And then when I graduated, I got hired by Caterpillar full-time. So I did like 4 or 5 different engineering jobs, just various, like more actually mechanical engineering instead of the data analytics stuff, which unfortunately, data analytics was my favorite, which is why it's great that I'm kind of back in that now. But so I worked there for about 2 years, just did a bunch of different engineering jobs. And then I actually quit my job on January 1st of 2019 to try to go play professional golf, believe it or not.
Really? I've been playing.
Yes. I had played golf my whole life, and I was obviously good, and I had always wanted to give it a shot. And it was one of those things like, you know, I'm only going to get to do this once, only going to get to try this once. So I decided that's what I wanted to do. So I quit and I moved to Scottsdale, Arizona, and I played on some small professional golf tours for a little bit. Didn't really make it anywhere. Never got to the point I needed to get to make it to like PGA Tour or anything like that. Mm-hmm. So after like 6 months of that, I had saved up a bunch of money from working as an engineer. So after that, I obviously money was running low and I needed to have an income somehow. So I self-taught myself all these programming languages so I could do web development. And that was like the middle of 2019, towards the end of 2019. And then I got a couple of freelance web development stuff going there where I built a couple of websites for people. And then the golf thing just kind of faded away. Just trying to do it professionally kind of just killed it for me. It was just too much. It was trying to practice 8 hours a day. It was really difficult for me. So passion kind of faded away with that, and I was looking for something else to do. I thought I was just going to do freelance programming. I had moved to California to continue doing the golf thing, actually, because where I live in San Diego is like perfect weather all the time, so I could play year round and practice year round. So that's why I came here. And then COVID happened, and I was stuck inside playing Warzone all day and got obsessed with it. And then that's when I decided to make True Game Data. And I was planning on just doing freelance programming. I just was going to be a programmer. That's what I was going to do. And then this opportunity popped up and I've gone all in on it from day one. I've been full time on it because I already didn't have a job. So it was just everything kind of lined up for me and came together at the right time.
I didn't have any idea of those things. And those are very hard life changing decisions that you made. Like, In a probably 1 year and a half or 2 year span, right?
For sure, yeah.
Impressive. So I have a very strict question, I would say, about the Ram 7. Here in South America, we have assault rifle Ram 7 as one of the favorites of most of the players. I guess the CR56 AMAX is a little closer than the others, but I don't see it shining as much as it shine here in other regions. And I don't know why and how it is not touched by Raven Software. I mean, maybe it would deserve a little nerf. I don't know how you see that. And I would love to see your opinion on that. Eu perguntei para ele sobre o fuzil Ram 7, que é bastante comum e bastante popular aqui na América do Sul, e que ele não é tocado por algum motivo nos últimos patches que nerfaram as armas, e como ele vê essas mudanças, né? Por que que acontece isso?
So it is really interesting. I've talked to, I actually know that because I used to play with Pimenta Rosa all the time and Haleko and those guys, and they would talk about that too. Basically the Ram 7, it has the same damage profile as the M4, Modern Warfare M4. It just shoots faster. So it has really good TTKs everywhere, and it has that 5.56 damage profile where it does the same to chest, stomach, and legs and arms. It does the same damage to all those different places, so it's super consistent. It doesn't matter where you shoot the person, unlike the AMAX or anything like that. To me, I feel like it's in an okay spot just because it's harder to control than the M4. So it obviously the recoil goes up into the left instead of up into the right like the M4 and most guns, which is might just be why people don't like it, because they don't give it time to get used to that recoil pattern going up into the left. But now with all these Cold War guns in their current state, like I talked about earlier, exactly, it's not gonna matter. You're gonna be using those for sure. But the RAM 7 is great. I mean, before Cold War integration, I pretty much exclusively ran the RAM 7 for any sort of sniper complement build, like it was my secondary for a sniper, and sometimes I'd use it as a main, but I just felt like I could never land enough shots as my main weapon, but that could just be because I didn't give it time. So I don't really think it needs a nerf, but that's obviously just my opinion. I mean, it is a very good gun.
Como você gosta de jogar o jogo? Qual que é o seu estilo de jogo? Você prefere os snipers, como você já deu uma sugerida mais cedo, ou você também gosta de rushar, de ficar bem cara a cara com o oponente?
I think I do a little bit of everything. I do snipe some. I do the recon strat sometimes as a way to relax. I do bounties all the time, aggressive play. But as far as like, I probably usually use like a main AR and an SMG. I've never really used shotguns. I'm much more of like a tactical, like positioning kind of player than I am someone who pushes buildings and is super good up close. I play much more, I don't know if smart's the right word, but like tactical is a good word for it. I try to have better cover than the enemy and just get an advantage in every situation I can. And I'm not like amazing, but I'm a pretty good player. And it's like the M16 meta was easily my best meta, because the M16 was so good if you had any sort of positional advantage on your enemy, because if they're in the open and you're not, they have no chance. Like the M16 was so accurate and had such high bullet velocity that I had like a 3.5 or 4 KD for a little while, and it was just purely because of the M16, and my playstyle combined worked really well for that. But yeah, I mean, I do a little bit of everything. I'd say mostly right now I'm running like the new MG82, the MG82 from season 4, or the Farah, I think, are two of the ones that I run a lot right now. And I usually use like either the LC10 or the PPSH. I think those are both really good right now too. So I do snipe sometimes, but usually I use a main AR and an SMG.
Well, Tony, thank you a lot for accepting this crazy idea of creating content for other people, for other language speakers. It's awesome. It's a first timer for me. So I would love to have you saying goodbye or saying something for your fans in Brazil, because they really follow your job and cherish every time you update anything on the site. They go to our live streams, my channel, Pimenta Rosa's channel, that I'm sure that you know already, and they comment a lot, and they say, they comment little tiny stuff about some detail or some weapon or two, and get really engaged on your work. So what's the message, what's the words that you leave for your fans in Brazil, and also say to them where can they find you on the internet, your handles, for everyone to follow you on Twitter, on Facebook, I don't know, on Instagram, ok? Então eu falei pra ele, muito obrigado pela sua participação, obrigado por topar essa ideia louca de criar conteúdo em outra língua. E pros seus fãs no Brasil, deixa aí um último recado e também deixa as suas arrobas das redes sociais pra galera te seguir.
So yeah, one of my absolute favorite things about all this has been just meeting people from around the world. That's been so, so cool. And Brazil has been one of the biggest, most supportive communities for sure, countries to use True Game Data. Like, it seems like people from Brazil that use the website are more supportive even than people from around here. So it's awesome to see. I appreciate all of you guys so much for all the support. We're gonna keep doing what we do. Hopefully get all the new season 4 changes out there for you pretty soon, and then the website will be up to date. Where can you find me? YouTube.com/TrueGameData, Twitch.tv/TrueGameDataLive, Twitter.com/TrueGameData. Pretty much just True Game Data everywhere. The only place it isn't is on Twitch. It's True Game Data Live. But thank you so much for having me. It was honestly an honor. It was awesome. I had a lot of fun. So
very proud to have you around. Muito obrigado. Espero que vocês tenham gostado. Deixe o seu like, compartilhe, se inscreva no canal. Lives todos os dias em twitch.tv/joguecomoogro às 9 da manhã. Conteúdo exclusivo no Instagram e no TikTok. Um beijo do Ogro e do True Game Data. Nosso conteúdo é diferente.